All right. How did we get back to that pool again? Wait, did we go left or right at the last intersection? Can I just see the map? What do you mean I have to keep track of where I am? Where in this dungeon am I? Let's talk about player mapping while exploring dungeons today. A recent comment on one of my other videos from Retro DM Ray, who by the way has some great videos of his own, got me thinking about old school mapping where... does it benefit the players or the game as a whole for players to create a map of the dungeon, you know, a map that's just for the players, created by the players, or is it just like a waste of time? Certainly, with a virtual tabletops like Roll20 and Fantasy Grounds, the whole idea of having a player create a map seems a bit pointless, now, especially if the DM puts one up on the screen anyway. But, you know, when playing on those systems, I typically use a map, but not always. Sometimes I go old-school theater of the mind, and that includes Roll20. Sometimes I draw things as we go, either on a ChessX map or even on, like, a Roll20 grid. This is because I have found that it often creates a more flexible environment, even for combat. Of course, you have to know your players and their levels of ability. Some people will really enjoy doing it this way, and some will not. But that's just because mapping can be a bit of a chore, especially like in a long dungeon. So you really want to kind of plan that out a little bit. I'm curious, though, how many players actually map the dungeon these days? Or do you just go with whatever the DM provides? Love a comment down below if you can tell me how you guys are doing it. For myself, when I first learned to play, I tended to end up as the unofficial cartographer of the group. This could be a bit of a challenge at times. It was all theater of the mind, and I was never allowed to peek at the DM's map. Sometimes I wondered if the DM even had a map. But when mapping, we never used feet and inches or any measurements like that. Instead, the fountain was about as big as a dumpster, or the tunnel goes about 2 football fields and then curves out of sight to the right, or the left, whatever. So when the party started to follow the curve, I wasn't given any specifics there either. It was more like, the curve continues for a bit further, and then the passage is now so narrow you're going to have to walk single file. But up ahead, looks like a wider tunnel branches off to the right, but this tunnel keeps going straight. So I would be, you know, scribbling all that out on my piece of paper. The idea was I would end up with a map, but it would never like be like an exact floor plan, like a draftsman drew it. The only time I ever got like exact measurements was if we were actually to measure something with weapons. Of course, it rarely mattered, and we didn't do it very often. As an aside, if you ever like want to see what it's like to carry a 10-foot pole, just like go to a hardware store and grab a piece of 10-foot PVC pipe and walk around a little bit. Even in those nice straight aisles, it's a bit unwieldy. I couldn't imagine carrying a 10-foot pole through a dungeon or cave or mansion or any other type of Dungeons & Dragons type of environment, so that was just kind of silly. But generally speaking, it was just enough to know how far apart things were from each other. If a combat was about to take place, the DM sometimes, not always, but sometimes, would pull out pre-cut pieces of graph paper, and then I could accurately copy those to my map if I wanted to. But that was about the only time I had ever had anything close to accurate on the map. That was okay, though, because like I said, it wasn't about creating an accurate map. It was about creating an accurate path. We would know how to get out of the dungeon when it was time to head back to safety. You know, time to head back and lick our wounds or whatever. And, you know, like we just had discussed there, if there had been digital maps back in the 80s, yeah, I agree wholeheartedly we would have definitely used them. I would have wanted them. But, you know, there is a level of satisfaction about actually mapping your way through and trying to get everything to line up in a way that makes sense. I would caution anybody considering this, though. If all you're going to do is give accurate dimensions and make it more of a game of broken telephone, then just share the map you have. Being abstract and saying the room was 20 by 60 feet with the long ends curved is fine. But, and I actually saw this once, the DM was actually saying, draw 4 squares on the top, 4 on the bottom. The room is a rectangle, about 6 squares apart. Now, don't fill in the sides of the rectangle. You need your pencil compass, set that to 34 degrees, and draw an arc connecting the top and the bottom. Now, that would not be fun to me, at least. Maybe to some people, but not to me. I think if that level of detail is required, share the map, because the characters are in the room, actually, and can see this, you know, these curved walls. But however you do it, virtual tabletop, Chessex, dry erase map, theater of the mind, it's just a game. I mean, if people are having fun doing it that way, great. I'm not telling people how to have fun. That would be just crazy of me. But for me, that would not be fun, so... And I think it's okay to skip mapping completely. If you want to try it and you enjoy it, you know, go for it. The only way to win is to actually enjoy the game. So I'm just curious then, what methods are you guys using when you're playing your games? Have you ever tried out player mapping? Did it work well? Did it not work well? Go ahead and throw a comment down below. Also, have you checked out my new D&D tips playlist yet? I'll leave a link for that in the description. Otherwise, catch you next time. Bye.
Hey, thanks for watching the video. Please give a like, share, subscribe, and hit that bell icon. Catch you next time. Bye.